Let's talk about functional global variables. We get asked, what are they? Why would I use them? Are they similar or better than single element queues or even actor engines in LabVIEW object-oriented programming? Let's first understand why they're valuable. And to do that, let's have a case study. We're going to peek into the life of a robot arm. This robot arm is being controlled by two different processes in an application. Both of these processes would like to move the arm at certain times. Process 1 moves the arm 10 units. Process 2 moves the arm 5 units. How can we program this? Let's first look at a problematic way to program it. Here is my robot main. The robot arm starts in some initial position. I run it for a certain amount of time, and then I stop it. This final position will show the final position of the arm in arbitrary units, 49,095. Let's look at the block diagram. You see that I have two loops, process 1 and process 2. And this global variable, we can tell from the globe, is keeping track of the position. We'll start over here. Because of data flow, we see that this section is going to execute first because it has inputs to these nodes. So we set the initial position of the variable, and then when process 1 executes, it takes the position, whatever it is, adds 10 to it, and writes it back. So in essence, it is moving the robot arm 10 units and keeping track of that. Process 2, on the other hand, also moves the robot arm, but it only moves it 5 units. So it reads the value of the position, wherever it is, adds 5 to it, and writes it back. Let's peek at this global variable just by double-clicking on it. And we have our global VI with just a numeric value. Pretty simple. When we're finished, we'll go and display the final position over here just by reading the variable. Now, what else are we doing? As you can see here, I'm looking at the iteration terminal, adding 1 to it since it's 0 indexed, and multiplying it by the 10 that process 1 moves the arm. So in other words, at the end of runtime, process 1 will have moved the robot arm 10 times the number of iterations of this loop, and that's what's output here. Similarly, process 2 will do the same thing, except it will be multiplying its number of iterations times 5. At the end, we'll add together the total distance that process 1 and process 2 has moved the robot arm, and that will be the loop sum. This should be equal to the global position, because all we're doing is adding up the total distance process 1 moved the arm and the total distance process 2 moved the arm. Going back to the front panel, we see that that's typically true. I run it, stop, it's true. I run it, true. Okay, let's run it for a little longer. And I'll pause the recording so you don't have to wait, and I'll go get a snack. I'm hungry. Okay, let's stop it. Interesting. As you can see, the final position here is 343,625. However, the sum of both loops is 343,635. In other words, 10 more. Let's run that again a few times. Well, they're still equal in most cases. I'll let it run again. And pause it again for you. I'm still hungry. I'll go get something to eat. Okay, that was tasty. Let's check this. Now look at this. This time they're off by 5. A little different. If I keep running this in this manner, we'll see that over time these will change and the value will change. But it's inconsistent. Sometimes they'll be exactly the same. Sometimes they'll be off by 5 or 15 or 20. What we see is a race condition. A race condition occurs when we have two processes trying to access the same shared resource. In this case, this position global variable. To see why the error is occurring, let's first look at what should occur. Well, at the beginning, we should write a 0 to here. Maybe process 1 goes first, reads 0, adds 10 to it, writes 10. Then maybe process 2 goes. It reads 10, adds 5 to it, 15. Process 1 goes. It reads 15. Adds 10 to it, puts 25. Process 2 reads 25, adds 5 to it, gets 30. And so on, back and forth, each adding their units whenever the process executes. And we can see that for the most part, that works. I can run this many times, and that value will agree. But then once in a while, as we see here, it doesn't. Well, what's happening then? What may happen, let's go back again, and let's say the position is at 30. Process 1 reads 30, adds 10 to it, but before it writes the 40, process 2 comes along and reads 30, adds 5 to it. And now the final value of position will be whichever one of these writes last. So in essence, one of their iterations will be lost. And so we see that when there is a discrepancy between the loop sum and the final position, the loop sum is always higher, because it's always accounting for every iteration. So how can we fix this? This leads us to the topic of information hiding in data encapsulation. If we go to our friend Wikipedia, we can see that information hiding in data encapsulation is the segregation of the design decisions in a computer program that are most likely to change, thus protecting other parts of the program from extensive modification if the design decision is changed. Very clear. You should donate to Wikipedia. What does this mean in the context of our LabVIEW program? What we'd like to do is protect a certain area of code so that there's one and only one way of accessing it. Since we have two processes trying to access the same shared resource, this position, let's encapsulate the section where we write to it. So what we have is a critical section of code right here and right here that need to be protected. And we can do that with a functional global variable. Now there are other ways of doing that, like we mentioned earlier. Actor engines in object-oriented programming are an excellent way of doing this, and there are many other ways. We are simply exploring one way. I'm going to rewrite this program so that every time I access this shared resource, I have to go through a functional global variable instead of this global variable. Here's the robot application rewritten with a functional global variable. This is our functional global variable. And we use it in the four places where we previously accessed the global variable, where we initialize at the beginning, execute process 1, process 2, and then read the final value at the end. Let's look inside this functional global variable. As you can see, it's a sub-VI. And if I go to my block diagram, I see that the code is pretty simple. Inside of my error handling case structure, I have a while loop with a shift register, and the shift register is uninitialized. So it maintains whatever value is in the shift register between runs of the VI, even though the VI has stopped. And in my case structure, I have four different cases. Initialize, where I put the initial position into the shift register. The read case, where I take the position out of the shift register and display it to the user, or pass it out of the VI. And then process 1, which takes the robot arm position, adds 10 to it, and writes it back to the shift register, and also passes it out of the VI. And as you guessed, process 2 does exactly the same thing, except adds 5 to it. Each time this while loop is called, it runs only one time, because I have a true constant going to the conditional terminal. So, as we can see, I'm calling this enum and first initializing. Then within process 1, I call process 1. Within process 2, I call process 2. And at the end, I read it. Now recall that the problem of the previous application using global variables was when both processes were inside of this critical section of code at the same time. You see now that with the functional global variable implementation, that never happens. Because the sub-VI is a non-reentrant VI, meaning it does not create duplicate memory spaces for itself. If process 1 calls the variable in order to move the robot arm 10, process 2 cannot access the variable at that time. It has to wait. Until this is finished, then process 2 can call it. Then process 1. The problem has been solved because of data encapsulation, or information hiding. Now I think you should believe me that the problem is solved. But just in case you're curious, let's do it. Run it, stop, run, stop, and I'll run it, and I'll wait for a while. In fact, I'll go make a whole dinner, because I'm kind of hungry again. And we'll see that when I come back, this loop sum and the final position, no matter how large they are, will be exactly the same. So hang on a minute. Okay, I'm back, and that was delicious. Let's stop it. Wow, big numbers. And they're exactly the same. That's very validating. Well, that's it for this episode. Stick around next time, and I'll actually make the functional global variable and put it into the first robot arm application to see exactly how it's implemented. And remember, we have a whole course full of this. It's 6 Clear Lucid LabVIEW Fundamentals Training. It's about a week's worth of me teaching you LabVIEW. So check it out at 6clear.com/LabVIEW Training.